Okay, we now come to the last of the modalities that I have selected, which is psychic readings. Well, this should be interesting. And I know a lot about psychic readings as a method of dealing with mental health issues, as I have a lot of experience in this area. Now, a little bit about my backstory. After I retired from clinical medicine in 2011 or thereabouts, I happened to encounter spiritualist services where mediums demonstrate mediumship in front of congregations and churches, which are open to anybody to attend. And when I first saw it, I couldn't believe my eyes, because here were people that were supposedly connecting with discarnate entities and providing information of a curious sort, which they gave to specific members of the congregation that happened to be there on the day. And initially I thought this was incredible, it was not possible. But the more I saw it, the more fascinated I became. And I became convinced that it was a genuine phenomenon of which I in my case, had no previous experience. And I became fascinated with this. And in the last 10 years, my life has pretty much revolved around observation of psychic phenomena, the work of mediums, healers, channelers, and people of this sort. And I can say, based on my experience, it is a genuine phenomenon, though how it works, I don't know. But very basically, to give you the basic concepts that underpin spiritualism are too large to discuss here. However, I'll say that as I currently believe, human beings, even though they think they might be alone, are not alone. The universe and is teeming with spirit life of different kinds and types. And part of this is the spirits of the deceased ancestors, which are still tied to the earth and is still interested in the lives of those, the loved ones they have left behind. Now, most people that hear about mediumship and things like this from scientific or so-called scientific thinking think it must be a fraud. And when I ask them why do they think it's a fraud, they say, well, how can it be true? It must be a fraud. I've yet to come across any scientist that has actually investigated the phenomenon, actually attended psychic events and so forth, and actually can declare that it is some kind of fraud. The people that claim that all this sort of thing is a fraud are people that have not actually seen or attended these events, and simply are making generalized conclusions based on on ignorance, which is actually not scientific at all. Anyway, whatever it is, I do believe that all this is quite genuine, and I have myself had psychic readings at least on a dozen occasions in the last few years. Now, I do want to mention a few things which I personally am convinced of, and that is aspects of a person's life are predestined. So it is quite possible that mediums pick up on a predestination of a situation and are able to do a certain amount of fortune telling, if they are, if I may use that term, based on this. There's a difference between so-called mediums and psychics, in the sense that to be psychic is to be able to look at a person and pick up a lot of information from, as it were, their aura. and things like this. This is nothing to do with cold readings. It's just the ability to tap into a person's, another person's aura and see what comes up. Mediums, on the other hand, are supposedly people that connect to the other person's so-called spirit guides. This is all a complicated area, and I'm not, I don't wish to go into it at this stage because it would be, require a lot of explanation. However, in the course of the last 10 years or so, I have been present at over 700 to even maybe 1,000 demonstrations of mediumship that have occurred in public places such as spiritualist churches in the southwest London area and central London. So these are, and I've seen a large number of mediums do their thing on what's called the platform and give messages to members of the congregation who happen to turn up on the day. Now, I have not come across a single fraud, case of fraud in my entire experience. And the numbers of frauds in this business are actually overplayed. And there are quite a large number of mediums that practice there. It is very rare to come across genuine frauds. Many mediums have some ability, but they might not be that good at what they do. That's all I can say. So I have yet to see any widespread fraud in the thing at all. And based upon and I currently help run a spiritualist church in southwest London, and my social life is entirely around people that have are mediums and practice this sort of thing professionally. So I know them quite well. However, for people who have any doubts about the matter or the idea that they are not faced with some kind of genuine phenomenon, I would suggest they read up or look up extremely well-known mediums, some of whose books have made the New York bestseller list. I'm just going to read the names of a few of them, and people can look them up online. People like James Van Praagh, Gordon Smith, Tony Stockwell, Suzanne Giesman, Betty Shine, Sylvia Brown, Ruth Montgomery, John Edward, Teresa Caputo, Rita Rogers, Lisa Williams, Doris Stokes, Estelle Roberts. These are some names. Some have passed on, and some are still with us. And when they do shows, they are usually sold out. How to find? Now, in my opinion, if people are open to this, if they are going through a distressful circumstance, and particularly if they are encountering bereavement, I would suggest that they looking up a psychic medium or arranging a sitting with a psychic medium is, in my view, a very valid way forward, and I would personally do it myself. But you've got to be open to this kind of thing. If one is given information during a sitting, take what, look at one's common sense and see what comes of it. But, so that's about psychic readings. I mean, I could speak all day, but I have to pass over this thing. But I do consider it as a valid form of therapy. Now, I've covered seven different types of therapy, but here I'm just going to summarize it by looking at by mentioning the fact that in all these things, what it depicts is that there is a variety in problem-solving methods. There's no one way of solving a problem. So people have to find to veer towards types of situations that appeal to them. Like some people might veer towards consulting a psychic medium, another might veer towards consulting a Buddhist psychotherapist. And it depends what resonates, and go with that. So basically, what I have to say is it's the human being's search for meaning. Now, all of us have three areas in life: health, wealth, and relationships. And within the context of these, adverse life events do occur. Okay, so when something like that occurs, the immediate questions that are asked is, why has this happened? Why has this happened to me? And why has this happened to me right now? So in answer to these questions, research that has been done on people. Now, if you look at the population as a whole, there are people who appear to have a faith in some kind of higher power, which is maybe a genuine faith, and there are people that have no faith in anything, you know, who believe that there is no God, there is nothing, no meaning to life, everything is arbitrary and random, and when you die, it slides out. Now, people with a faith in some sort of higher power fare much better than the other category. This has been shown. And it would appear that faith in some kind of higher power does give people the kind of resilience to carry on with their lives and find meaning and stuff like this. So when something like this happens, there are people that who have a faith in something that might think, well, things happen for a reason. And there's a higher purpose in what has happened to me. How do I learn from this? And how can I use this for some kind of my personal growth or spiritual progress? And tied in with these questions are things like, who am I? Where am I going? Why? What is this life? And questions of this kind. So in answer to this, traditions like Buddhist psychotherapy, transpersonal psychotherapy, healing, hypnotherapy, and consulting a psychic, in my view, definitely offer very tangible help for people. And they do genuinely help people in dealing with difficult life situations. They are helped in learning and growing from them and finding meaning in them. And finding meaning in life is what helps us carry on, really. So there is a question about whether a belief in a higher power is, as in some respect, hardwired into our brains. And interestingly enough, research shows that there's a lot of work done on this. And if people are interested in this particular topic, this is actually a highly researched area. And if you Google Dr. Andrew Newberg in the United States, he has done extensive work on what is called neurotheology, or the idea of looking for particular patterns in the brain that suggest that religious belief or that kind of thing, to what extent is it like hardwired? Do we have like a God gene in our DNA or what? So that's a very interesting area of research. And that's what I'm going to say about all this at this time, and I'll come to the next bit of this talk a little bit later. Thank you. Having covered all the seven different modalities of therapy and different so-called problem-solving methods, I'm now going to focus on something I have called commonalities. And I call these commonalities because they can be common to any kind of therapy approach that that the therapist offers. So any therapist should really assimilate stuff from many of these things, because they can be helpful in all situations and form part of the repertoire that the therapist offers. So I'll just, I've chosen something like 7 different modalities to briefly touch upon. And they are meditation, mindfulness, diet, exercise, and social prescribing, emotional intelligence, the law of attraction, and the cultivation of positive thinking. I'm going to speak some about the Kubler-Ross model, and last of all, transactional analysis. Now, these are topics out there in the general field. And my plan, these are all big topics by themselves, right? So I'm only going to touch upon them briefly. And the plan is to summarize very briefly a few things I think are important, and perhaps tell you 2 or 3 things about things like meditation and mindfulness that you may not have encountered before in quite the same way. So I'm going to keep, I have to keep, by the very nature, I'm going to keep it very brief. And let's see how it goes. First of all, meditation. Now, everybody understands that practicing regular meditation, or something that goes by that name, is of great value to mental health, keeping good mental health, and there's little doubt about that. However, among the points I wish to bring in mind is that, first of all, the techniques of meditation were never developed to promote mental health as such. In my view, meditation can give rise to 2 specific things. One is they can give rise to specific experiences of spiritual nature. And the second thing, meditation will teach you about the nature of mind. And in things like Buddhist meditation, this is one of the most critical things, to understand how the mind works. So to do that, you have to observe the mind as though you're trying to observe it and just see what goes on and develop some kind of impartial perspective. So that's a thing. And generally speaking, if one understands, gets a greater understanding of how the mind is constructed, how it works and how it behaves, one can separate the wheat from the chaff in mental activity, because as an old Sanskrit saying goes, the mind is man's best friend. It is also his worst enemy. So to understand in what ways your mind is your best friend, and to understand in what ways your mind is your worst enemy and how to make practical use of it, is what meditation will often help you explore. Now, one of the things I wish to state is that there are different methods of meditation. For example, there are body scanning techniques, there are visualization techniques, there's the use of things like mantra, as in transcendental meditation, and other things of this kind. Now, I'm not aware of any research that exists as to what actual method is best. So people say, I'm a meditation teacher, but so 3 meditation teachers might be teaching different forms of meditation to their pupils, and one doesn't know how productive these techniques are. So it's a broad term. So if somebody says, I teach meditation, one has to inquire, what kind of method do you use? Now, from a therapeutic point of view, if you're a therapist looking after a mental health patient, one thing I say is that you need to keep things very simple, and perhaps find, be aware of different techniques and suggest techniques that might be doable by your client And it's very important for people to find things they like. Because if you do not like a thing, you won't persist with it. So you have to find practice that you kind of like or you can relate to and you can do often and daily and things like this. So based on what I have read, there are apps like Calm and Headspace, which are said to be quite good, though I can't specify that. Now, I know a lot about meditation because I have been myself as a person practicing meditation techniques since the middle of the mid-70s. So it's a long, long time, over 40 years. And it has done me an immense amount of good, I think. So that's about meditation very briefly. And it's quite important for a therapist not to suggest to a client that they get involved in any heavy-duty meditation class. It might do more harm than good. So keep things very simple, keep things... keep things simple. Here's a little thing about mindfulness, which is... there's absolutely no doubt that this is a very valuable life skill. Very briefly, mindfulness is the ability of the person to live by the day, by the minute, by the moment, and not get so one's activity, brain activity, is not too much trapped in the future or the past. So it's about focusing on the day, and this makes one much more productive. There's no doubt about this. And the fact that it is very, very useful in mental health. However, mindfulness, in my opinion, is an artificial state. It is not natural to human beings, except in children maybe. But once one grows beyond childhood, it is not a natural state. It is a state that is acquired. Now, I have been focusing on mindfulness practices since, I think, the late 1970s. So again, nearly 40 years of work on this field. So, and I can say to what extent my experience has shown is that it takes a great deal of time, effort, perseverance to get anywhere with this. So it takes years of practice to actually cultivate it as a thing that you can actually employ. To understand mindfulness, one of the things I think it should be to understand some of the functions of the ordinary mind as I see it. Now, I would say that about 30% of the, as it were, electricity produced every day in the brain is simply recycled into past memories and to sustain what is called a memory bank. Because at all times, a person has to remember who he is, all factors about himself. So, for example, if somebody says, "Who are you?" I have to instantly remember my name, my address, who the people close to me are, various aspects of what I identify myself as being, and lots of other data that I regard as personal to me. Now, that is constantly being recycled in my brain. To keep it up, and this takes a great deal of neurological or electrical activity. So in mindfulness, a lot of that activity, the plan, like Buddhist monks, for instance, they are meant to practice mindfulness 24/7, 365 days a year, and gradually their minds change until they can divert this, as it were, this brain activity or electricity into the present moment. Until they become less reliant upon past memories and future worries. So you're living much more in the present. But this is a thing that, in my opinion, takes a lot of time and perseverance. It is... Okay, with a practical thing to understand about mindfulness and mental health is something I've taken out from one of the books of Eckhart Tolle, The Power of Now, which... goes into mindfulness at great length and is in fact about mindfulness. So according to Eckhart Tolle, things like guilt, resentment, grievances, sadness, bitterness and all forms of non-forgiveness are suggestive of the person having too much past and not enough now. Things like unease, anxiety, stress, worry, and all forms of fear suggest that the person has too much future and not enough now. So by becoming more here and now, a person gradually over time will become less slave to the past and future and these types of emotions. So that's the rationale behind the cultivation of mindfulness. But this is a long process, and it's not that easy. And a therapist has to keep this in mind. But how does one approach mindfulness from the point of view of a therapist? In my opinion, start with, if you're the therapist and you've got a client that is quite new to mindfulness, don't get them to read any heavy book or anything like this. Focus on them practicing mindfulness in day-to-day, everyday activities. Now, all of us have to do hundreds of things every day that are part of normal life. I mean, we have to cook, we have to wash up, we have to load the washing machine, we have to clean our house, we have to do tons of stuff like that. Take cooking, for example. It's quite possible to take a lot of care and preparation, put attention into the preparation of items before they go in, while you're cooking. It's possible to do washing up with a lot of attention. You know, feel the texture of the water, the utensils, whatever it is. It can be used like that. People have to wash clothes, but one can load the washing machine very mindfully, very carefully, and one can hang clothes to dry very carefully and mindfully. So one can sweep floors mindfully, a mop and stuff like this. So there are hundreds of things that can be done in each and in everyday life, which are perfect. Which are as good as sitting on a meditation couch. And it's quite helpful, in my opinion, to practice mindfulness through everyday activities and not focus on simply some kind of meditation type activity. Before I finish on the topic of mindfulness, I'd like to discuss the concept of kindfulness. Mindfulness is something that is quite an intellectual concept. So people have an idea of kind of with a Zen-like focus on the here and now, and it's quite an intellectual concept. And perhaps when one starts off, these things do need to be intellectualized, but that's only to start with. To actually experience the benefits of mindfulness, it has to become an activity that is an emotion. In other words, the knowledge of the head has to become the experience of the heart. So kindfulness is about experiencing mindfulness as a kind of emotion and as an enjoyment. So being able to enjoy the here and now, it's like being able to enjoy a meal, you know, having the taste of fine food, maybe fine wine, a fine dessert. You know, it's about experiencing beauty, symmetry, all kinds of things. It's a very enjoyable experience, and also the experience of feeling of being kind. One feels the quality of compassion and kindness first of all towards oneself, and once this is grounded, one starts to feel it towards other people around one and other situations. So all charity starts at home. So one has to be, so in my view, kindfulness is the thing that has to be aspired to. And this is actually an experience, and people will come to it, I expect, in their own ways and experience it in their own ways. But mindfulness by itself is too intellectual a concept. The felt part of it is in my view the important thing. And that's the end of my talk on mindfulness. I'll now go on to other things. Diet, exercise, lifestyle, and social prescribing. These are obviously very, very important components of to do with mental health. And there's a chapter in my book on all these. But there's actually a huge amount of information out there in the general domain. So I won't focus on stuff that is covered much better elsewhere. I would suggest that if a therapist wants to understand the best, get the best information that is out there at the moment, they subscribe to Dr. Rangan Chatterjee's podcast and channel and look through all his books, because they contain the most up-to-date information on everything pertaining to diet, exercise, lifestyle, and also deal with the very important bits to do with social connection, which are absolutely essential to good mental health. So, and his podcasts are really, really good, and I would recommend them highly. Now, but my job here is to tell you something that you may not have come across before. To do with posture and exercise and mental health, a very interesting feature is something that was discovered by a person called Wilhelm Reich, who was a follower of Freud in the early part of the last century, and then his ideas were later taken up by Dr. Alexander Bowen, who developed the Bowen technique. So I'll talk to you a little bit about Reichian therapy and the Bowen technique. Now, according to these kinds of things, there's a very great connection between subtle muscular posture and habitual postures and specific emotions. This can be actually very interestingly understood by the idea that, for example, when we are sad, we tend to take a bowed fetal kind of posture. Now, the next time you feel very low and find yourself with a bowed or curled up posture, try straightening your neck, broadening your shoulders, and see if you can maintain that sad emotion. You'll find it's impossible. So for people that are going through a particular emotion, if they want to attenuate it, simply change your posture, and it you'll notice it immediately alters, because some emotions are held associated with very specific muscular tensions, and if you change those muscular tensions, you get an immediate relief from it. Which is why things like massage therapy, etc., are often people feel much calmer after that. And things like diazepam, that's the tablet that is used both for calming people down as an anesthetic and is used in anesthesia for muscular relaxation. Its probable mechanism of action is to facilitate muscular tension. And if you have muscular tension that is released, there's a relief of mental tension as well. Now, in connection with this, there are some kinds of meditation practices where posture is everything. Because in these kinds of types of techniques, which I have experimented with, the posture of the spine and the neck and the head is really important, and so that the head, the neck, and the spine are held in such a way that they are neither too forward facing or backward. So you're neither aggressive nor defensive, but trying to be aware and simply aware. And if you experiment with posture like this, you see in a subtle way, this is a profound benefit in looking at muscular tensions and things of this kind. So consequently, unaccustomed exercise like dance and running and sport will definitely provide a change of mental state for somebody that is not accustomed to doing these activities. So that may be a way it works as well. Now, so from a therapy perspective, as far as all these things that concern diet, exercise, lifestyle, and social prescribing, certainly as far as diet is concerned, don't bang on about it. Obviously, if people have a junk diet, then that can be improved. But leave things be and approach things quite gently to start with until the person really wants to change. Wants to change and improve the situation. As far as social prescribing is concerned, a therapist can have a unique role in the sense that many clients who are depressed are also socially isolated. And although they might have family and friends, they have often broken off contact with them long ago and can find it difficult to ask for help from them. But it's quite possible for a therapist to speak to them and just say, look, I've got this person as a client and he's quite, he would benefit very much from having social connection with you. And you can facilitate the introduction so that they become, so a client can connect with people that they are close to. So a therapist, this is a simple method in which a therapist can really help there. And as far as social prescribing is concerned, it's really important to look at volunteering opportunities. And often if clients can't do this for themselves, it's quite possible for the therapist to Google the area that they live in and look at volunteer opportunities, particularly animal shelters and things like this, and take an active role in finding the client volunteer opportunities and things like this, because that brings them into contact with other people and that's very good for their mental health. I'll just now deal with the subject of emotional intelligence. Right, there's a great deal written about it and there's a chapter in my book. So emotional intelligence is critical to people's ability to network and form successful social connections with others. And some of the characteristics of people that have high emotional intelligence, for example, there's the ability to self-reflect, there's the ability to pause, there's the ability to praise others, there's an ability to demonstrate empathy, there's an ability to be authentic, there's an ability to benefit from criticism, there's an ability to offer constructive criticism, the ability to forgive and forget, the ability to keep commitments, the ability to control thoughts and feelings, and the ability to help others. These are some of the criteria that that people with high emotional intelligence often have. Now, the importance of all these from a therapist perspective, it's quite important to actually do questionnaires or do a study of the patient from an emotional intelligence point of view. And the value of this is that all these traits can actually be learned. So if a person tends to have a difficulty, for example, inability to pause. For example, they immediately reply to emails that they receive. They can be taught, no, hold on, sleep on it, do not reply to anything immediately, take your time, sleep on a problem. So a lot of things can be taught. So this is an ideal area in which therapists can help a client improve on all these things, and they can actually be given specific tasks that they have to then report back to the therapist about how they are doing. So that's it. Okay, the next topic on my list is the topic of cultivating positivity. there's something called the law of attraction, which is very popular in, and there are lots of books on it, really. And one of the things that is stated is that what you focus on will grow. That's actually very important. What you focus on will grow. So if you focus on the positives in your life, they will grow. If you focus on the negatives in your life, those will grow. So if your mindset is all about what you lack, what you're not getting, and stuff like that, then it'll you will tend to attract more of the same. This is and to some extent this is true, because we know that a person with a positive mindset is likely to attract more positive outcomes. This is very common sense. I mean, if you are if you're trying to find somebody to do a job, somebody with a very positive outlook that how can I help, will be much more employable than somebody that always has a thing, what's in it for me, that kind of thing. So, from a therapist's point of view, they have to help the client reduce negative self-talk. Because a lot of people have a huge problem of heaping blame on themselves. And it really is a benefit if one can see the good that is in one, rather than focus on what one thinks is not quite right. And also to help them cultivate a positive self-image. This is quite important and quite a big part of therapy. Now, there are numerous techniques that are out there, and there's a lot of literature on the subject, so I won't go into it in detail at all. A thing I will say about it is that in common, a lot of these techniques involve the practice of gratitude. So for instance, the therapist might ask the client to every morning to sit down and write down 5 things that they can be grateful for in their life. This can be, I have food on my table, I have shoes on my feet, I have a roof over my head. Find 5 things that you can be thankful for, and gradually, over time, one starts to, in this way, through journaling and gratitude, the practice of gratitude, gradually people do build a kind of self, a view of themselves which is based on self-worth and actually gratitude. And there's a huge belief out there that the universe tends to meet you halfway. If you ask ask what you want, but also you have to practice receiving the universe, and then synchronicities and stuff do come your way. This I believe. Now, as far as clients and therapists are concerned, in my belief, therapists should start small and go slow. So they should not give a client any big task. Focus on very small things that the client can actually do, and build on very small successes. For example, if the client tends to have a problem with assertiveness, and they are a bit like a doormat, and everybody walks over them, the client can perhaps give the therapist can perhaps give the client a few very simple tasks which are very doable, very easy to do, on how to be assertive and how to say no to people, for example, and how not to worry if they are not liked. So things of this sort. The next topic I'm going to deal with is the issue of adverse life events. Now, many people that deal with bereavement counseling will have encountered the Kubler-Ross model, which states that people go through certain phases. such as denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance. There's a huge amount of literature on the subject. And these stages can occur not just with grieving, but with any adverse life event. But what is curious about the Kubler-Ross model is when I did some research on it, the model that many therapists currently use and understand is wrong, because Kubler-Ross, actually, the study that she based this on is were people that were actually dying. They were not people that were grieving. So these five stages actually represent people that receive a terminal diagnosis, and they go through the stages until they accept the fact that they are, you know, going to pass over to the next world. So I found that a curious anomaly in the system. But whatever it is, one of the reasons I brought this topic up here is that, in my view, that from a therapist's perspective, the client will have to go through their own an adverse life event in their own way, and do it in their own time. So I don't believe that there is any specific formula of how things progress. For example, when you know anything goes wrong, different people will take their own time and deal with things in their own way. And actually, the therapist's role here is to actually support the client while they are going through this process, but not attempt to interfere with it by giving too much advice or attempting to force advice down a client's throat, or trying to fit the client into some preconceived formula. I don't think there are any formulas for this kind of thing. And each person deals with things in their own way. And in my view, in this particular regard, the therapist has to think of themselves in a bit of a parental role, like when parents have children, or people have children, as the children grow up, parents will often have to practice tough love, and responsible parents will understand that their child will have to understand, make their own mistakes and learn from them. They can't, a parent can't live a life for a child. So they, you know, and they have, and they're often helplessly forced to watch their children go through different difficult phases, difficult challenges, and find their own ways to face them. And parents' role there is to be kind of supportive, to be there when they need them, but not to over-interfere in their child's life. And this, to some extent, must be the job of a very good therapist. They need to be able to be supportive of the client, but obviously in an adult-to-adult manner, because they are not the client's parent. But nevertheless, this is a perspective that I think is quite useful. This is going to be the last slide in this particular talk series, and it's about transactional analysis. Now, transactional analysis arose from a book written by a human behaviorist called Eric Byrne in the 1960s, called Games People Play, which became a bestseller in its time. And he theorized about analyzed the transactions that occurred between people, and which gave it its name, called transactional analysis. Now, according to him, people tend to operate in kind of compartmentalized ego modes. And he theorized that each person had a sort of a parent mode, an adult mode, and a child mode. Now, the parent mode had two main things, called the controlling parent and the nurturing parent. And the child mode, he said, had three forms. One was the natural child, the little professor, and the adaptive child. So he theorized that when people when people reacted with each other or transacted with each other, one particular ego, one particular mode related to, was in transaction with another mode in another person. So in an ideal world, you want to adult mode. But let me give you two examples. Now, this is a model that is very valuable in therapy and applies to doctors and therapists equally. Let me give you two examples from, say, a doctor consultation. So, for example, if a patient comes to see me and in my consulting room and says, "Doctor, look, I know you're a very busy person. I know what's wrong with me. Just give me this prescription and I'm out of the door." Right, so that is presenting the doctor with some kind of fait accompli. And no doctor likes that. And if you analyze that transaction, the patient is acting like a controlling parent attempting to treat the doctor as some kind of child. So it's obviously it doesn't, these consultations don't really work. You get another type of consultation where a patient might come to the doctor and say, "Doctor, look, my life is in your hands. You decide how what to do about with my thing." So, and no doctor likes to be put into that situation because the patient is like a child attempting to treat the doctor as a de facto parent, asking the doctor to make decisions on his behalf. So that's just a kind of example. So in all kind of transactions between doctor and patient and client and therapist, really they should be nudged up to see that they're adult to adult mode. So it's like one adult having a mature conversation with another adult. So this is the ideal. So I've always thought of this as quite a valuable consultation analysis tool. So with this, I'm going to end this particular bit of the talk 3, which was on a whole bunch of therapies. And I hope you'll join me for the next talk, which is about something completely different and what it means to put all the other stuff you have previously heard together in order to kind of set up in practice and so forth. So see you then.